Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the ReConnect application workshop. So before we get started on our next session, the application system introduction session, I'd like to turn it over to the Rural Utility Service Administrator, Christopher McLean. Chris?
Thank you very much. And my name is Christopher McLean. I'm the Acting Administrator of the Rural Utility Service. My day job is to be the assistant administrator for the RUS Electric Program. And thank you so much for your participation in today's event. And thank you also for all that you do each and every day to be able to connect rural America to its digital future. On behalf of the Rural Utility Service and the United States Department of Agriculture, welcome to the ReConnect Round Through Funding Webinar. We are very excited about this funding opportunity. It builds on the tremendous success of rounds one and rounds two of ReConnect, which funded over 180 projects across the country, valued over $1.5 billion. And this funding round is the next step in our agency's amazing public-private partnership that stretches back to 1935 for electricity and 1949 for telecommunications. And in this funding round, we're going to make over $1 billion of loans, grants, and loan grant combinations available. And this round in particular raises the bar on bandwidth for both eligibility and build to speeds. And that raising of the bar was highly informed by our experience as a nation with the pandemic over the last almost 2 years now, which proved once and for all that rural Americans' needs are the same as those of urban and suburban American needs when it comes to bandwidth. You have to be connected to a robust, high-capacity network in order to be able to fully participate in our economy, especially when we face challenging times as we have over these last 2 years, where remote school, remote work, remote healthcare have been critical to be able to keep our country together and moving forward. And the particulars of this funding round were also highly informed by all of the comments that we received from the public when RUS published its draft ReConnect regs last spring. And as your attendance attests, and I look at that amazing participation number inching up over 320 participants as we speak, from what we see in our responses in the application portal, round three seems to be very well received and getting positive feedback. And this is very, very gratifying. So you'll hear today about new features in round three, some which make grants dollars available to the most unserved areas, and also notably how the agency has feathered its support in with existing programs from the FCC as well, the Rural Digital Opportunity Fund, so that we can make our programs work together rather than have them not be complementary with each other. So as you begin this day of great information, I encourage you to learn as much as you can about this program. The number one rule about participating in funding opportunities like this: you can't win if you don't enter. We know this is a big lift in order to do the application, but this is very, very serious business, and we really want to help you succeed in your efforts to deliver high-capacity bandwidth to your communities. I wish you well. This is an exciting opportunity, and thank you for your support, not only for broadband deployment, but for the ReConnect program as well. And good luck as you proceed in these closing weeks of the application window. And if you have any questions, our team are available to be able to answer them. And you're in for a very interesting and exciting day. So thank you very much. Good luck to everybody and have a great day today. Take care.
Thank you very much, Chris. Our presenter for our first session of the day is Chris Proctor and the application system introduction session. Chris?
Good morning. My name is Chris Proctor. I'm a management program analyst with the RUS telecommunication programs. I've been with USDA Rural Development for going on 8 years now, and the past 3 years I've spent with the telecom programs, primarily working on the ReConnect program, and I'll be your presenter today. So happy to be here. Next slide, please. In this session, we are going to cover some key steps and general guidelines for using the application system. I'm actually going to go into the system and do a live walkthrough of the application system. We'll at a high level cover each section, but I'm going to do some deep dives into some specific sections. We'll also talk about some additional resources that are available to applicants as they're working on their application. And then we'll finish the session with Q&A. So I'm going to encourage folks to enter in your questions and using the Q&A button through Zoom, and then we'll hold those questions until the end, where we'll answer them. Next slide, please. So today's session, we are going to provide an overview of the entire application system and then do a deep dive into specific sections of the application system. Those sections are really going to focus on the sections of the system that aren't going to be covered in later workshops happening today and this week. So we're going to really focus on those and provide a high-level overview of other sections of the application. But first, we'll talk about some first key steps for creating a ReConnect application. The first thing folks need to know is that the application is completely created and submitted online using the ReConnect intake portal available on the ReConnect website. The browsers you want to use to work on your application are Google Chrome, Microsoft Edge, and Mozilla Firefox. You do not want to use Safari if you're on a MacBook or Internet Explorer because you are likely to run into issues with our system because the system was designed to work on Google Chrome, Edge, and Firefox. So please do not use Internet Explorer or Safari. Next slide. A few tips for when you are in the system. When working on your application, click the Save button often to ensure that your work is saved. The application is not going to auto-save your work. So you've got to manually click the Save button on the page that you're on in order to save your application. The system will also log out applicants after 10 minutes of inactivity. Another good reason to save your work, because if you have to step away for 10 minutes, then the system will log you out. As you're completing the application, just keep in mind that the application is going to flow in the way that it's designed. So the project section is going to flow into the network section. The network section is going to flow into the financial section, which I'll demo here shortly. So you really want to complete the sections in order to avoid any sort of issues occurring in the system or data being removed or changed with the application that you're working on. Everything that's going to be covered today is also in the application guide, which I encourage folks to take a look at on the ReConnect website and download. Additionally, there are going to be workshop sessions throughout the week on all of the different major application sections. So I encourage folks to attend those sessions that are going to be happening. Next slide, please. So getting set up in the system, new ReConnect applicants will need to obtain level 2 eAuth ID credentials. In order to get that level 2 eAuth ID, you have to go through an identity verification process. And you will do that by visiting the eAuth website that we have listed up here, eauth.usda.gov. It's really important that you get the level 2 eAuth ID because the level 1 ID will not provide the appropriate credentials. After you've gotten the level 2 eAuth ID, the next step is to submit the authorized representative request, or ARR. Additional details on the ARR and the process can be found in the application guide. For returning applicants, You may or may not need to submit a new ARR to gain access to the system. Once you log in with your level 2 eAuth ID, you will receive a pop-up that tells you whether or not you need to submit an updated ARR with the updated board resolution that we have up on our website under forms and resources. Next slide, please. All right, so now just give me 1 second. We're gonna switch into our live demo where we will get into the application system and we'll start with account information. So just bear with me while I share my screen. All right, folks should now be able to view my screen. So I am going to pull up my internet browser. I'm using Google Chrome and I will go into the ReConnect system the same way any other normal applicant would. I'll visit usda.gov/reconnect. And then I will click on the Apply Now button. On this screen is where you'll enter your level 2 eAuth ID before getting into the system. And then after your authorized representative request is approved and you've logged into the system, this is the screen that you should be seeing. You'll see 3 boxes, one with accounts, one with authorizations, one with public notice filings. You'll see your name in the top right and the entity also included in the top right. I am going to go into my own test account so you all will see exactly what happens when you click on the account header. So one important thing about account information is that it must be completed before ReConnect application can be started. Some of this information is going to come in from the ARR that was submitted. Examples include the legal name of the applicant, the TIN, and the DUNS. And I want to walk through the account information section because this is one of the sections that we don't cover in a lot of details in some of the upcoming workshop sessions. A number of other fields need to be completed manually by the applicant. This includes the cage code, your physical address, and you can see some of these required fields have an asterisk next to them. Correspondence address, phone number, the eligible entity type you'll select from a dropdown, civil rights status, congressional district, if the applicant is regulated by a public utilities commission, if the applicant is required to file an EEO1 report, and then you have 2 radio buttons here at the bottom. Is the applicant a startup formed from partnerships of existing utility providers? And does the applicant own any real property? Now I will jump to the next page, which is organizational documents. Applicants should upload required organizational documents to this page. The eligible entity type will determine which documents are required to be submitted. The system will also determine required documents in the section once the applicant has selected their entity type. So you can see some examples of organizational documents are resumes of key management, broadband operations experience, articles of incorporation, amounts of common and preferred stock issued and outstanding, your legal opinion, resolution of utility authority, evidence of legal existence, evidence of good standing with the Secretary of State, your org chart, board of directors, and lastly, your bylaws. I will now jump to parent information. So this is the 3rd section of the account information. This is only applicable if the applicant has a parent company. If no, then there's no information that needs to be inputted. If yes, then there's going to be some information that needs to be completed about your parent company. The same goes for affiliate information. If you select the yes radio button, then you'll be asked to upload information about any affiliates. If no, then you can proceed to the next section. And lastly, you have subsidiaries. If you indicate yes, you do have a subsidiary using the radio button, then you will have to upload information about those subsidiaries. Any documents uploaded in the account section are going to be housed here under account documents. Applicants can return to this page to view or update any previously uploaded documents. If you're a returning ReConnect applicant, your documents will carry over. However, all applicants must file an updated legal opinion and account information. So that is an important note if you are a returning applicant. But you can see I've uploaded different documents throughout the account information section, and they're all appearing here. They can be viewed in this section. I can replace the upload or I can delete the upload here. All right, so next I'm going to show folks how to create a new application. You'll go to Active Authorizations to view your existing applications and also to create new applications. When you log into the system and go into your authorizations, you should see a blue Start New Application button near the top right. After you click that button, you will be asked to fill out certain fields, one of which is the funding type. You'll select between the four funding categories for this round of ReConnect: 100% grant, 100% grant for tribal governments and socially vulnerable communities, 100% loan, and 50-50. You'll select the application year. You'll indicate whether or not the applicant is a publicly traded company. You'll also indicate whether or not the applicant will replace the standard grant security agreement with an irrevocable letter of credit. These questions are very important because they will affect other sections of the application. These answers also cannot be changed. So once these answers are completed and you select the next button, you can't go back and change it. You'd have to start a new application. If, say, you did want to indicate yes, you'll be replacing the standard grant agreement with an ILOC. So I am going to go back and go into one of the applications that I already have started. And for the purposes of this demo, I will use the 50-50 loan grant combination that I've got in progress. You can see there are, I'll jump back for a second. There are a number of applications that I have in progress. Looks like I have five applications currently in progress. It's incredibly important to keep in mind that only one application can be submitted. So although I've got numerous applications in progress, I can only submit one of these. All right, so now I will go into the application for my 50-50. And I want to provide a high-level summary of each application section. And then the sections I really want to dive into are project, licenses and agreements, certifications, documents, and summary submit. Because we have dedicated workshop sessions to these other sections, service area through evaluation criteria, I'm really going to focus on project and then the last four application sections. So you can see that there are 10 green headers. This is because this is a grant loan application. If there's a grant component, there are going to be 10 headers. If you were working on a 100% loan application, there will only be 9 green headers or sections because there is no evaluation criteria for 100% loans. Those applications are awarded on a first-come, first-served basis. We highly recommend completing the application from left to right, so starting with project, then moving to service area, then network, so on and so forth, and also from top to bottom. So within project, completing project information, then NEPA review, then project documents, starting with network design, then working your way down. This is because you're allowed to skip around in the application. And I know multiple people a lot of times are working on an application, but the entire application is interconnected. So information you enter in one part of the system is gonna flow into other parts of the system. So service area is gonna tie into network and financial. So if you change a service area, then it's also going to change the information that you entered into financials and network. So just please keep that in mind. So I'll start with just a high-level overview of project and just work my way through. In the project section, the applicant is going to summarize and set the framework for the application. This is where the applicant provides general information about their project. This includes description of the project, description of key management, description of pre-existing operations, and more. Also included in this section, applicants specify the level of environmental review process that's anticipated. And of course, applicants should complete this section and avoid changing information before moving on in the system. Next, I'll provide a high-level overview of service area. In this section, the applicant will define their proposed service area of the project and any non-funded service areas. This section informs the structure of many of the subsequent sections, including network, financials, environmental, and evaluation criteria. Applicants should ensure they're familiar with the functionality of the service area map before they go in and draw their NFSAs and PFSAs. In the network section, the applicants will provide information on the proposed network design, the timeline of their build out, the cost of all required assets, and the timing of capital investments. The network design must be certified by a professional engineer in the state in which the project is taking place. If there are multiple states, then at least one of the states where the project is taking place, the professional engineer needs to be certified in one of those states. This section has to be completed before moving on to the financial section. In the financial section, applicants provide information related to historical and forecast financial performance of the applicant. An applicant can submit their financial information using a calendar year or fiscal year basis for historical and forecasting, but the methodology has to be consistent across all years. If the applicant is using fiscal year financials rather than calendar year, these assumptions need to be clearly defined. In addition to 4 years of historical data, which for this fellow would be 2017 to 2020, applicants will be asked to provide the bridge year financials, which will be 2021 for this FOA, and projected financial statements for the next 5 years, so 2022 through 2026. If a 100% grant applicant uses an irrevocable letter of credit as security, the applicant does not have to submit financial projections nor meet the FOA's financial ratio requirements. This is the same for publicly traded companies with an investment grade bond rating. Within the financial information section, please only use valid characters. Numbers, negative signs, and decimal points are okay. Please don't enter any other type of characters. The system will not save if it recognizes an invalid character. Also, please don't leave any sections blank. Instead of leaving sections blank, you should input a zero before you save. Next is the environmental section. In this section, applicants provide information about how the proposed project will affect the environment of the proposed area. Within the section, the applicant draws the construction map and completes all the necessary environmental questionnaires. These are your project, site, or route, project, site, or route, and your section 106 EQs. This is going to assist in determining what sort of impact the project will have on the environment. Next is the evaluation criteria. This section is where applicants will answer questions prompted by the system and upload documents that assist in the scoring of the application. The map that applicants draw in the service area section is going to feed into calculations performed by the system to calculate the result in the evaluation criteria summary subsection. Evaluation criteria is only going to appear if the applications are 100% grant or a 50-50 loan grant combination. It's not going to apply to 100% loan applications. Next is licenses and agreements. In this section, applicants can provide an assortment of uploads to demonstrate that the proper agreements are in place based on the proposed project. Next, we have certifications. In this section, the application rep signs cert will agree to adhere to the required agency compliance rules on behalf of the applying entity. The document section is for easier management and reference. It's going to house all of the documents that you uploaded throughout the application. Users can use the document section to upload, view, download, delete, and replace application files all in this, single tab. And then lastly, we have the summary submit. This section is where the applicant can review the application before submission. If no issues are encountered during validation, the applicant can then submit the application. Only the RepSign cert can submit the application. Applicants can also generate the application PDF from the summary submit page. So now let's take a little bit of a deep dive into the project section. And again, we're going to just be focusing on a few sections here because these sections won't be covered in as much detail throughout the workshop. So within project, we'll start with project information. So once the applicant clicks on project information, this is the screen that you'll see. Applicants must answer the required items that have an asterisk next to them. Please note that the way an applicant answers these questions are going to affect other sections of the application. An example here is the first radio button. Does the applicant have any unadvanced prior loan funds made under the RUS telecommunications program? If you answer yes, then you'll be asked in the financial section to provide more information on those unadvanced prior loan funds. If you answer no, then you will not be expected to provide more information on those unadvanced prior loan funds. Any subsequent changes to these questions will remove data in later sections of the application or create new items to be completed. So that's incredibly important. If you answer yes, that you have unadvanced prior loan funds, and then you enter information on those unadvanced prior loan funds, and you come back to this page and then answer that no, you don't have unadvanced prior loan funds, then those sections will be removed. So that's just an example of changing information in one section affecting information in another section. A few other key questions on this page is if the applicant is requesting SUTA consideration. If so, SUTA documents must be uploaded. There's a question on if the applicant is proposing to provide service on tribal land. One important piece here is that applicants proposing services on tribal lands must submit a tribal government resolution of consent. This is outlined in the FY22 FOA. If you don't provide that resolution of consent, then the project will not be funded. Also, you have two radio buttons here on is the applicant a publicly traded company, and is the applicant replacing the standard grant security agreement with an ILOC? You saw we answered these questions when we started the application, and so I'm unable to change them. So this information was pulled in from when I started my application. An additional question, if you are working on a 100% loan, you'll see a question on acquisitions. The question will say, will any part of the loan funds be used for an acquisition? Because this is a 50-50 application, or if I was in a 100% grant application, those funds can't be used for an acquisition. So that's why you're not seeing it here. But if you do answer yes to that question, then you'll be expected to upload additional information on that acquisition. This question must be answered, and you can find more information on the application guide if you have any questions about an acquisition, if that's a part of your project. Next, the second part of the project information is the executive summary. Once the project information and acquisition information, if applicable, is complete, this screen is going to prompt the applicant to enter the executive summary information. All of these questions are required. So the first is asking for a description of existing operations. Second question is asking to discuss key management. Third question is the description of the company's workforce. Four, there's interactions between any parent, affiliates, or subsidiary operations. And then lastly, we have a description of the proposed project. So these are, this is a completely narrative section. If you have more information that you want to provide, say, for example, you have a strategic broadband plan that you want to provide, and it's 100 pages, rather than putting it here, there is a project document section, which I'll get to in a second. But next, we'll go to the NEPA review. On the NEPA review page, this is going to indicate the level of environmental review that you're anticipating with this project. You have two drop-down buttons here to indicate whether or not you're anticipating an EIS, environmental impact statement, or an EA. If you're not sure, we highly encourage you to reach out to RUS through the Contact Us form on the USDA ReConnect website. This is going to help to avoid any issues down the road. So if you need additional guidance on environmental review and are not sure the level of environmental review that your project is going to require, please reach out to RUS. The last section, which I just briefly mentioned, is project documents. Here you can view your uploaded documents that were uploaded through the previous screens that we just went through. As you finish the project section of the application, just keep in mind that everything is going to affect other parts of the application. So your project documents, anything uploaded here will show up in the larger document section. But project documents, this is for anything that isn't captured through the project section that we just went through. So next, we will go to licenses and agreements. As a reminder, the sections we have skipped over in this session will be covered in greater detail during other workshop sessions. The application system is going to contain 13 different agreement types that cover real estate, technology, and facilities. Applicants must assign a status to each license and agreement, even if it doesn't apply to your project. And you can do this by selecting the little caret at the very right of the agreement. You have the option to delete, view, and if you click upload, you'll see here we have an agreement status where you can select between these options: not required, draft, existing, no amendments needed, existing amendments needed, applied, approval pending, contingent upon award, and contingent upon availability of funds. The upload requirement is going to depend on the status that you select in this table. So if you select not required, then of course you will not be required to upload a document. You can see here though, the different types of licenses and agreements that you can upload supporting documentation for. We have building lease agreements, fiber lease agreements, pole attachment, tower lease, video franchise agreements, so on and so forth. Next, we will go to certifications. The certification section is where the Rep Science Cert signs the certifications and then supplies any additional required information. Here you can see an example of a certification, the certification regarding architectural barriers. The Rep Science Cert will use the checkbox on each certifications page to sign the certification. This is going to record the user ID, the date, and the timestamp of the signature. You can add, delete, or replace additional documents for the certifications on the certification documents page, which is here. So I'll just quickly go through each certification so you can see what the checkbox is going to look like. So here we have certification regarding debarment suspension and other responsibility matters. You've got a click to acknowledge and upload any supporting documentation, and then select next. Flood hazard area precautions. you indicate whether the project is located in a 100-year floodplain or not. And if you know your entity, the applying entity has flood insurance, you'll acknowledge that certification. Next, we have a certification regarding lobbying for contracts, grants, loans, and cooperative agreements. After you acknowledge this, you'll move to the civil rights compliance assurance certification. Next, we have the federal collection policies for commercial debt certification, where you indicate whether or not you are delinquent on any federal debt. Next, you have the Uniform Relocation Assistance and Real Property Acquisition Policies Act of 1970 certification, which you'll need to acknowledge. And lastly, you have the compliance with RUS award documents. Next, we will move to the Documents tab. The Documents tab will allow applicants to delete, replace, and add more documents to the application. Each application section has a document section, but this tab here is going to allow you to see all documents that have been uploaded throughout the entire application. So you can see in this table here, you can see the section in which the document was uploaded, the document type, a description if you've entered it, the file name, the user that uploaded it, and then the date and time of the upload. A green check mark is going to indicate that the document has been uploaded successfully. If you don't get the green check mark, then you will want to try again to upload the document. One important document that's going to be captured here is your draft application PDF. So you can see that's always going to be the very last document on this screen. You can see that this draft application PDF was generated about a month ago, December 15th at 3:11 p.m. So whatever my application looked like at that time, that's the PDF that was generated. And a second here will generate a new PDF because as I'm sure over the course of a month, many changes can happen in an application. So we will generate a new PDF that'll be the most up to date with the information that's in this application. And we will do that. It's a perfect segue into the summary submit, the final section that I'll discuss. And while I discuss it, I'm going to go ahead and generate the PDF because generating the application PDF can take a little while, especially depending on the number of uploads that you've put into the system, the amount of data that you've entered. Larger PDFs can take a while to upload. I don't have a very large application that I've been working on, so it shouldn't take too long, but we'll give it some time to generate while I walk through the validations that you're seeing on this page. After you feel like your application is in a good place, you can then validate the application. So if you click validate application, the system will check your application for any errors. So you can see that there are sections within this application that are incomplete, and you'll see that indicated by a red status icon. And my application has been downloaded, so it's ready for download, and I'll come back to that in just a second. If you get green, then that is good. That means that the section is complete. There were no warnings. There's no errors. The section is fully complete, so you're good to go there. If you get yellow, that is a warning message. You can submit the application with warning messages. You cannot submit an application with any red and complete statuses. The warning primarily is going to show you sections that are optional that may be helpful to the agency in reviewing the application. So the warning is not going to be for any required document, but if there is an optional document that was not provided, then you are likely to get a warning message. So you can see that I would not be able to send this application because I have a number of incomplete sections. So really what we're looking for on the validation is all green or green and yellow is also acceptable. The nice thing about the summary submit page is that if you do get a warning or an error, an incomplete message, you can click the required action link to the right, and it'll take you directly to exactly what the system is warning about or what needs to be completed. So I'll just go into this environmental warning that we're receiving. And it's taking me right here. It looks like it's a document upload that the system is warning me about. So I will jump back now. And we got the message that the application PDF download was complete. So now when we go back to manage uploaded documents, we'll see the new date here. So you can see the date time. It's no longer December. It's now January 18th, 2022 at 10:47 a.m. So my application PDF that I can save is now up to date and no longer reflects information that I had in the system in December. The last thing I'll mention on summary submit is that, again, only the rep signed cert can submit the application. Submission of an application does not constitute a finding that the application is eligible or acceptable. So that's just one thing to keep in mind. Just because you submit the application doesn't mean it's necessarily eligible. So with that, I think that is a high-level overview of the entire system, and then a little bit more information on project licenses and agreements, certifications, documents, and summary submit. I have a few more slides to go through. So Taylor, I'm going to ask you to bring back up the slide deck. Great. Thank you, Taylor. So here we have some available resources. If you visit the usda.gov/reconnect/events page, you'll be able to see any upcoming webinars or workshops that we're having. I mentioned this at the start of the presentation. You can also download today's agenda for this workshop at that link. Our application guide, everything I've covered today is in the application guide, and then some. Every workshop session that you'll hear over the course of this week, that information is also going to be within the ReConnect program application guide. So I encourage folks to review that document and then download it so that you guys have it. ReConnect website, in addition to the application guide and looking at events, we've got fact sheets, we've got frequently asked questions. We've also broken those frequently asked questions down into different sections. So on eligibility, on just general application questions that we received. So there's just a wealth of information on the ReConnect website. We also encourage you to go to the contact us page if you have any questions. That's the best way to get your questions in and to get them answered in a quick manner is to go through the contact us. We have people that monitor the contact us page that are dedicated to monitoring the contact us page. And so they're usually able to get you a response rather quickly or get you to the person who can give you the appropriate response. We also have a link to the FY22 funding opportunity announcement. I encourage folks, if you haven't done so already, that's going to cover a lot of important information about the ReConnect program for this funding round, everything from scoring criteria to funding available, types of funding available, whether it's grants, loans, combinations, all that can be found in the FY22 FOA. The regulation, I also encourage folks to take a look at. Within the regulation, you'll see the statutory language that backs up the ReConnect program. So this is information that it likely is not going to change from round to round. And then lastly, we have the general field representatives. We encourage folks to reach out to your GFRs. These are the telecom staff located across the country that can assist you, whether you're interested in ReConnect or any of our telecom programs. If you visit the link, you can view a map of the US and click on your state and then find the contact information for your respective GFR. We've got their emails and their phone numbers up there. So if you have any questions, As you're working on your application, or if you're considering a telecom application, then we recommend that you reach out to your local GFR. Next slide. All right. And with that, hopefully folks have been putting questions into the Q&A box as I've been going through the application system. I will now do my best to answer as many questions as possible. And I believe we have a moderator who's going to be reading some of the questions.
Okay. Good morning, everybody. This is Joan Kaiser with the RUS staff. I am a colleague of Chris Proctor's. And Chris, thank you so much for going through the application system. We got lots of questions for you. And as Chris mentioned, please do go ahead and put questions into the Contact Us link if you would like to. Chris, the first question is for you from James Renard, and it's a little bit of a long one, so I'll just go slowly. Will RUS be coordinating with NTIA to post any updates to the available areas prior to the closing of the ReConnect application that may be funded as part of the NTIA $288 million broadband infrastructure program? He's asking so that we would be able to modify our PFSAs accordingly to ensure that we do not apply for an area that may be receiving federal funding.
Yes, that is a great question. And I knew interagency coordination was bound to come up at some point because, you know, as James mentioned, not only does USDA have broadband funding, but a number of other federal agencies have broadband funding, including NTIA, FCC, and Treasury, just to name a few. In short, yes, James, we will be coordinating with NTIA and all other federal partners that have broadband funding to ensure that we are not overbuilding existing networks. You will not see any sort of layer in our application system that indicates federally funded broadband areas. I know we've done that in the past, but we have not. We've removed that for this funding round. We will still conduct the service area validation process for any area that receives a public notice response. We go through the public notice filing process, so all service areas that are submitted as a part of a ReConnect application will be made publicly available for 45 days, and then incumbent service providers can challenge service areas during that 45-day window. If there is a challenge received, then RUS staff will go out to that service area to determine whether or not service exists. So hopefully that thoroughly answers your question. We are coordinating with other federal agencies and using all available information to determine whether or not an area has sufficient access to broadband as it's defined in the most recent FOA.
Thanks, Chris. Thank you so much for the answer. I'm going to go ahead and take the next one. It's just a quick question from Jennifer Gilliam. She asks, is a new legal opinion needed if you had one from ReConnect Round 2? Yes, Jennifer, we are asking that you submit a new updated legal opinion just because projects do change between rounds, and we want to make sure that your legal opinion covers the current round of funding. Chris, this one's going to go to you. It's from Sarah Byard. How long until you get account access after you upload your ARR resolution?
Yeah, that's a great question. Usually we have a small team here that handles the authorized representative request. Usually we can get back to you same day, but we ask that you give us at least 48 hours. It's been incredibly busy over the last few weeks. I've worked on ReConnect since the first round, and I don't think I've ever seen the level of interest, the number of ARRs that we're getting at the moment. So we do ask that you give us 48 hours. If for some reason it's taking a little bit longer than anticipated, then a member of our team will reach out and explain to you what's going on with the ARR, you know, why it may be taking a little bit longer. But if everything looks good with the ARR, which a lot of them are submitted and look good, then they could be, they're usually approved same day, but it'll usually take a little bit longer if we're seeing issues with the ARR. So 48 hours, but sometimes quicker.
Thank you. Next up, another one for you, Chris. John Carlisi has asked, How long does it take to get a level two authorization?
Yeah, that is a great question. And I think one misconception is that, you know, USDA, RUS issues the level two e-auth IDs, and unfortunately we do not. We can tell you whether or not your e-auth ID is level one or level two, but there's an e-auth office that handles all e-auth authentication IDs. I believe it's relatively simple to create a level one ID. To upgrade to the level two ID, you have to go through an identification verification process, an identity verification process. There are two ways that you can verify your identity. One is using by completing the online questionnaire. If for some reason you answer a question incorrectly or you can't get through on the questionnaire, then you have to go to a local RD office to verify your identity. So I would say you can, in some cases, complete it same day if you're able to do the process online. If you do need to go to the local RD office, just depending on your schedule, it may take a few days. So if you do need to get your level two e-auth ID, I would just, you know, prepare that it might take a day or two or possibly longer, depending on where your local RD office is, if you need to go there.
Great, thank you so much. Another e-auth account question has come up from Eric Rapluski. He says, when setting up a new account, what type should be selected? Customer, USDA contractor, other federal contractor?
I believe there you want to select customer, because that should give you all the proper permissions that you need once you get into the ReConnect system. I would not select a USDA contractor or other federal contractor. Our applicants are going to come in as customers.
Great. Thanks so much, Chris. I'm going to go ahead and take the next question. Brent Fisher has asked, is the CAGE code required for submission? In addition, I'm going to combine that with Amanda Molina's question, which says, in SAM.gov, there was a message that CAGE codes are not being provided after October 2021. What should new SAM.gov registration accounts enter into the CAGE code fields? Yes, the CAGE code is required. The system's not going to let you submit the question without a CAGE code. However, if you are not able to obtain the CAGE code, you can just type zeros in. Give us a note in the application, put a little note in a document and upload it under Manage Documents at the end and let us know so that our reviewers can catch it and either reach back to you or double check in SAM.gov if they need to. I hope that answers both Brent and Amanda's questions. Chris, the next question I'm going to put is for you from Tina Jordan. She says, we are regulated by a state utilities commission, but depreciation rates are not regulated. Do I select yes and just not upload PUC depreciation rates since they aren't regulated?
This is a really good question, and this is actually going to be applicable to probably a lot of folks and then a number of applicants that feel this way about a specific section. If you answer yes to a specific radio button and you feel that the upload should not be required for you, then we're going to ask you to upload some sort of supporting documentation explaining why you're not providing an upload. So in the case of Tina, they're regulated by a state utilities commission, but they don't have the depreciation rates are not regulated. We would just ask that you provide information that essentially outlines that, saying, yes, we are, but you know, our depreciation rates are not regulated. So please include that in place of the regulated depreciation rates.
Thanks, Chris. I'm going to go ahead and take the next one, which is from Michelle Owens. She asks, if an applicant is seeking a 100% grant, do they answer the real property question in the account information section? She says, we found an answer that indicates we should say no as a 100% grant applicant. Is that correct? That is correct. You should just answer no if you are a 100% grant applicant. I'm just going to dig up some very quick language here for you. Give me just a moment, Michelle. basically, since you're asking for a 100% grant, there's not going to be a mortgage attached to it, which means we don't encumber, we, RUS, do not encumber the real property on the assets with the grant funds. So I hope that answers the question for you. The next question, Chris, I'm going to send to you is, how is affiliate defined?
All right, thanks for that question. So affiliate is actually defined in our legal agreements. So if you visit the ReConnect website and you navigate to forms and resources, you can download the various different types of legal agreements that we have. Some are, you know, loans, some are grants, some are loan and grant, and some have mortgages, which Joan just alluded to with the real estate question. But the affiliate definition, I'll read it to you from our legal agreement. Affiliate or affiliated company of any specified person or entity means any other person or entity directly or indirectly controlling of, controlled by, under direct or indirect common control with, or related to such a specified person or entity, or which exists for the sole purpose of providing any service to one company or exclusively to companies which otherwise meet the definition of affiliate. This definition includes variable interest entities as described in Financial Accounting Standards Board interpretation number 46R. For the purposes of this definition, control means possession directly or indirectly of the power to direct or cause the direction of the management and policies of a company, whether such power is exercised through one or more intermediary companies or alone or in conjunction with or pursuant to an agreement with one or more other companies, and whether such power is established through a majority or minority ownership, voting of securities, common directors, officers, or stockholders, voting trust, holding trust, other than money exchange for property or services. So I know that was a very legal definition, but that is our definition of affiliate or affiliated company. And again, you can go to our ReConnect website under Forms and Resources, and that's captured in our various legal agreements.
Great, Chris, thanks so much. Next up is a question that says, should we delete old account documents that were uploaded from the previous rounds, or is it okay to leave them?
So it is going to depend. If those documents are still relevant to your current project, I would encourage you to leave them. I would do a thorough review of those documents because, as was mentioned earlier, and as Joan just mentioned, certain documents will need to be updated for this funding round, like the legal opinion. So I would encourage you to take a look at your account documents. They will carry over if you're a returning applicant. So if you applied under round one or round two of ReConnect, then you log in for round three, you will see your documents. So we encourage you to review those. Some may still be applicable, some may need updating. The system isn't going to tell you that. So please take a look, and we're going to encourage folks to kind of do their due diligence to see what needs to be uploaded, but updated. But the legal opinion will be one of those documents.
Thanks, Chris. We have another quick question from Tina Jordan that I'll go ahead and answer. She asks, application year option is 2021. Is this not an application for 2022? Hi, Tina. Yes, you're going to be submitting your application in February of 2022 or before. It's okay that it says the option is only 2021, and that's the only option available to you. When the system changes were originally put in, we were assuming a much shorter schedule. Things did get pushed back. So go ahead and use that 2021 for the application year option. Chris, next up is a question about the tribal resolution of consent. Is a tribal resolution of consent required only for non-tribal applicants applying for funding on tribal lands? Or is the resolution also required if the applicant is the tribe itself on their own tribal lands? And do applicants need approval from all tribes who overlap with an area, or just those that might be impacted?
So I am going to refer to the FOA, which says that any project that overlaps with tribal land will need that resolution of consent. That is a requirement for this year. So if you're overlapping with multiple tribal lands, then you would need multiple tribal government resolutions. So yes, that is a requirement. If an applicant fails to provide that certification, then the PFSA and the application will not be considered for funding. So yes, that is a requirement for all applicants.
Thanks, Chris. Next up is a question from Hillary Rosenthal, who asks, is there any way to just view the application without starting to fill it out?
I might need some additional information here. So in order to access the application, you do need to go through the ARR process with your level 2 eAuth ID. After that is approved, then you can go into the application system and then start an application. That's the only way to get into an application to view it, is to have the level 2 eAuth ID, have the ARR approved, and then to get into an application that way. So there's no other option to view an application any other way. So hopefully that makes sense.
Thanks, Chris. Hope you don't mind if I add on to that. You can also go through the application guide, which is available on the ReConnect website. I know it's a very lengthy document, but part of the reason it's so long is there are lots and lots of screenshots, and it goes into great detail on every section of the application. And so you'll be able to actually view the sections of the application and the accompanying screenshots in the guide before you start filling it out. So Chris, next up is a question from Christina St. Germain. How does the ARR enable staff to work in the application?
Yeah, that's a good question. The ARR is really the starting point to getting to the application system. And so when you submit the ARR, at a minimum, you have to, during that process, identify the rep sign cert. This is the person that is going to submit your application. They sign your certifications. This is the one individual who has all user permissions. They are kind of leading the application, are the ones that can submit the application. So during the ARR process, you at least have to identify that person. A lot of times we see folks identifying other users during the ARR process. This can be an administrator who also can go in and make changes in the application. They can assign other users. They cannot submit the application, but that's really the only restriction that they have, is that they can't submit the application and they can't sign the certifications. You also have rep update datas who can go in and work on the application, but they can't add other users. And then you have the consultant role, which is pretty similar to the rep update data, but these are folks that are not employed by the applying entity. So one, you have the ARR process where those folks are included and they can be added through that process. But also after the ARR is approved, folks can be added to the application. You know, new administrators can be added after the ARR is approved. Rep update data, consultants can be added after the ARR is approved. So you have a set of users that are approved when the ARR is submitted and approved. They're given, you know, their permissions, but also a number of folks can be added after. So that's a little bit of background on how the ARR and user access works. It's really up to the rep sign cert when they want to add users, whether it's during the ARR process or after the ARR is approved. I do encourage folks to primarily add users after the ARR is approved, because if you submit the ARR and you have a bunch of users listed, then those users also have to be named in the resolution. And if they're not named in the resolution, then we have to reject the ARR. So really the simplest way to go about it is to ensure the resolution states who the rep sign cert is, place the rep sign cert, you know, their contact information during the ARR process and their level 2 eAuth ID. And then after that is approved, then go in and add everyone else. I think that's that's the easiest way to get into the system quickly and get folks added.
Great, thank you. Next up is a question from Tina and Jordan for you, Chris. Can a parent make an application and a subsidiary make a separate application, or would it have to be one combined application?
I believe the answer here, and correct me if I'm wrong, Joan, is yes, a parent and a subsidiary can both submit an application. There's no restriction there. There are a number of pieces of the regulation that you'll want to review on, you know, different financial requirements if the subsidiary is going to be using the parent financials, and so on and so forth. But I believe yes, and parent and a subsidiary can both submit an application.
Yeah, absolutely, Chris. The only thing that I would add to that is the subsidiary would need to be sure that it's eligible based on all the financial and technical considerations throughout the regulation and the funding opportunity announcement, just as if they were applying by themselves and their parent wasn't even considering a separate application. So again, you just have to be able to do that sort of on your own with or without your parent's audited financials. Next up is a question that says, I know it's best to start at the beginning of an application and work towards the end, but can work go ahead and be done in the competitor service offering section since it takes time to input? I wouldn't think this data would flow to another screen, would it?
The competitor service offerings, I do believe that's one section that does not flow into the financials. I believe this is captured under network and should not flow to any other financial section. So, I mean, there are sections here or there that aren't dependent on other sections. So I do believe that's one section that you may be able to complete. But again, we highly recommend completing the application in order so that you don't run into any issues down the road. And I think that that's really just the best practice for when you're in the system.
Great, thank you. Somewhat similar, we have a question from James Renard who asks, can financials and environmental sections be worked on simultaneously without impacting each other?
Yes, the environmental section is not going to tie to any other section. So that's kind of another one of those exceptions to the rule where environmental is not going to impact your financials or anything else that you've entered.
Thanks, Chris. Next up, another one from Christina St. Germain. She asks, do the narrative questions have character limits? I'll go ahead and answer this because I kind of have it off the top of my head. The little program description that would be made public if your entity wins an award is limited to about 75 to 100 characters. So that needs to be pretty short. All of the longer narratives, for example, the executive summary, have 32,000 character limits on the field. So that should help. If you do actually run out of space, it's okay to continue the description that you need to write in a separate document. Just put a note in your application that that separate document is a continuation so that the reviewers do catch it when they're going through your application. Next up is a question for you, Chris, from Judy Imlay, who asks, does the environmental questionnaire involve more than just whether it is an EIS or EA?
So Judy, there are two sections sort of where you're answering this question. So under project, you're going to indicate whether you anticipate an EA or an EIS. And then you have the environmental questionnaires, which is going to be informed by the construction map. So where you're drawing your sites and routes, and if they're overlaying with wetlands or any sort of federal lands, things like that. That's where your environmental questionnaires are going to be captured, not under project where you answer the yes or no buttons, but under the environmental section. So there you might have, your project, your site route, your section 106 EQs. That's going to really be determined by your construction map and how you answer some of the questions in the environmental section. So hopefully that answers your question. Yes, there is more than just that project section where you're answering yes or no to whether or not you're anticipating the EA or the EIS. It's just captured later on in the environmental section of the application.
Thanks, Chris. Next up is a question about the certifications. Does the list of required certifications in the portal were included in RUS's February 21st, 2020 FAQ on certification inquiries include all certifications that an applicant must make when applying for ReConnect funding, including any certifications required to register for SAM.gov for purposes of this program?
Yeah, so it does require, it does include all certifications when applying for ReConnect funding. I'm going to have to follow up on the certifications required to register for SAM.gov just because I'm not as familiar with all of the certifications required for that SAM.gov registration. So I would actually encourage you to submit that question through our contact us form if you haven't done so already, and we can follow up to get you the right answer there.
Thanks, Chris. Next up is a quick question from Christina St. Germain. Where's the save button?
So each page in the application system is going to have a save button. It's going to be a blue button. Let me see if I can actually pull this up so I can show you. I'll just share my screen for a quick second here. Just give me 1 second. So I will go into project information. And then, so you can see, sometimes it'll be, it depends on which page you're on. Sometimes it'll be in the bottom right, sometimes it'll be in the top right. But each page will have this either save button or save and continue button. I think when you get into some of the financials, then that button is gonna be in the top right. So we'll go to the balance sheet, for example. And so it's actually here down in the bottom. So you'll see a blue save button on each page where you can go in and save what the work that you're working on.
Great. Next up is a question that says, to be clear, all this information must be completed and submitted by February 22nd, 2022.
That is correct. The application deadline is February 22nd, 2022. So at 11:59 a.m. Eastern time. So yes, everything, the ARR, the account information has to be completed, the 9 or 10 different sections, depending on the application type, that all needs to be completed by February 22nd at 11:59 a.m. Eastern time.
Great, so the next question up is, where can we get the actual language of each required certification? That's from Paul Jarvis.
I believe it's all there in the application system. Paul, let me take that back. And if there's anything additional we can provide, you know, for example, if you're not in the application system and you want to be able to view the various certifications, that might be something that we can provide either by posting on our website or by sending to you directly.
Thanks, Chris. So the next question up is, how much money is being given out?
So for this funding round, we have $1.15 billion available in grants, loans, and combinations. There is a max, I believe it is $200 million available for 100% loans. The maximum award amount is $50 million. For 50-50s, this is grant loan combinations, there's $250 million available. The max award amount is $50 million, and the grant and loan amount must be equal. So it can be $25 million loan, $25 million grant. For the 100% grant, there's up to $350 million available. The max award amount is $25 million under that funding category. But if the Applicants' PFSAs are comprised 100% of areas classified as FAR level four, then they can request up to $35 million. And the same goes for 100% grants for tribal governments and socially vulnerable communities. Up to $350 million is available. $25 million max for those projects, unless 100% of the service areas are FAR level four, then $35 million can be requested.
Great, thank you. Just want to let everybody know, excuse me, we have about 4 minutes remaining. We've gotten lots of questions in, so thank you for all of your questions. We're not going to get to all of them, but do remember, if you have a question about a specific aspect of the application, for example, the evaluation criteria or the financial section, we do have a workshop session on each detailed section for you throughout the next couple of days, so you want to check back in and perhaps attend that session. I'm going to go ahead and ask just a couple more questions here, and then we can go ahead and wrap up Q&A. So, Chris, another question here about the EOTH. At what stage do we add company details in the EOTH application?
So your level two EOTH ID, that's at an individual level. So each individual who wants to access the application is going to need a level two EOTH ID. So that information is just about you. So you'll enter, your contact information, your email address, your EOTH ID that you would like created, and your password. So there is a company level EOTH ID. Your EOTH ID is at an individual level. So you want to make sure that every member of your team that needs to access the application has their own EOTH ID.
Great. And we have a question from Cheryl Gomez that says, can it be granted for a new ISP without customers yet?
So you do have to meet the minimum financial requirements, which do require you provide at least, I believe it's a year of your audited consolidated financials. So in order to be eligible and to apply, you do have to be able to provide financials for the audited consolidated financials for that past year. So that is outlined in the regulation.
Great. Here's another quick one from Darian Warren. Can counties and municipalities apply for this grant?
Yes, absolutely. Really the only ineligible types are going to be individuals, they cannot apply, and then co-applicants. There can only be one applicant applying, but other than that, municipalities, nonprofits, telecom providers, cooperatives, for-profit organizations are all eligible to apply.
Great. I think we have time for one more quick one, which is, what do you mean by rounds? Can you apply for money multiple times?
No. So when I reference rounds, this is just referencing the different ReConnect funding windows that we've opened. So the first window, I believe, was in 2019, and then we opened a second window or round in 2020. So we're currently in the third round in 2022. But only one application can be submitted. You cannot submit an application for 100% grant and a loan and a combo. You can start applications for these different funding types, but you've got to pick one, and then you can only submit that one.
Great. I think that's all we have time for, Chris. Thank you so much, everyone, for all of the great questions.
Yep, not a problem. Thank you all.